Okay, yeah, so the subject is about disaster resilient buildings, and we will first today what I'm going to do is I'll introduce you to the contents. What are the contents that is discussed in this syllabus, and also maybe we'll start with very preliminary discussions on what are the types of disaster that we have. Okay, so some definitions about disaster and also types of disasters, if time permits. Otherwise, what we will do today is we will just explore the contents of this course, and also I will tell you what are the things that that can be done in this course, and what I'm trying to do during the course of the time. Okay, and also I kindly pay attention to the contents. At the end of the class, I request all of you to take one topic for you to study. Okay, so you can pick any one of the keywords from this subject, and then you have to develop reading. You have to generate reading materials based on the topic, and you will present it as your work, as your understanding, as an assessment 3. Okay, maybe at the end of the semester. I have kept last 3 weeks for presentation of your work. Okay, so that means you will read through this semester any one topic. I'll also describe it as we progress, but just pay attention to what is being said. Okay, so if you see the syllabus, what is the objective of this course? There are certain specific objective that is spelled out in the syllabus itself. Okay, first is the course is designed to provide an overview of all the natural and man-made disasters. Okay, and all kind of natural disasters related to resilient buildings. Okay, of course, natural is predominantly discussed. Man-made disasters are also discussed, but not to that extent. Okay, so that is the first one of the objective of this course. The second objective is to equip the students, in this case, with skills and improve their understanding of disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation concepts. Okay, so these are two key words that we have to understand, and these are very commonly used words these days, right? Disaster risk reduction, what can we do to reduce the risk? Okay, we cannot avoid disaster. Okay, so but we can prevent the extent of damage that we encounter. Okay, so if you see, for example, let's say earthquake that has taken 100 years back, and the impact that has created, and the earthquake that we face today, and the consequence of it. Okay, we have improved a lot, and we have improved in terms of science and technology, and also our understanding about disaster, how it impacts, all that. Okay, so we are preparing for it. We can't negate it, but we do have developed certain skills and certain understanding and certain technologies and science that will help in reducing the damage. Okay, at least prevent the loss of life. That is the ultimate aim of all these measures that we take. The second concept that is highlighted here is on climate change adaptation. Okay, so we all agree that there is evident change in the way climate is perceived, or climate change is observed. Okay, increasing temperature, increasing rainfall, not receiving enough rainfalls in a year, and so on and so forth, and other things. The recent one being in the the disaster that took place in Dehradun, right, or Uttarakhand, right. So all these things, what we can do, what is our understanding of it, what Government of India does, what other countries do, and what we as an architect can learn from it, what we have to know when we design buildings and when we plan cities. Okay, so that is the second objective. we will develop certain skills in terms of design, in terms of planning, in terms of best practices that we can think of. The second one. Third one, emphasis is given on traditional knowledge as well. Because see, these disasters are not new for us. Okay, climate change is happening from thousands of years. Okay, so in probably in one of our class, we will see a documentary on the Inconvenient Truth. There's a documentary called Inconvenient Truth, where the basics of climate change has been discussed, and then followed by there is one more documentary, it's called Before the Floods. Okay, so probably in one of our class or sometime, we will see both of this video and both of these documentary to understand how climate change has occurred over a period of time and how it impacts how it impacts our day to day life. Okay, so this the first documentary that I talked about, it's on the Inconvenient Truth. It is way back. It is I think now 2 decades back. Roughly 2 decades back, the documentary was done, and recently in the Paris Climate Change Conclave 2015, the second documentary was prepared. That was streamed during the climate change conference, Paris Agreement, or they call it Paris Conclave, right? So during that time, a documentary was prepared to educate the common masses about climate change and its impact on day-to-day life. Okay, so there is when we discuss about all this new science and technologies and other things, we should also know the traditional knowledge. Okay, so these are not new things. Many of the disasters that we are encountering are not new. Okay, so people have cities have been affected by such similar disasters in historically. Okay, so what we can learn from history and what our forefathers have done when the technology was not there, okay, when the advancement in science and technology was not there, so what measures did they take, okay, to encounter or to counter this disasters. Okay, so that is also one of the best part that we should know and appreciate as well, what we can learn from the traditional knowledge. So there is one chapter which discusses about traditional knowledge and its integration in the current course. Okay, so just once again, somebody is trying to log in. Okay, so that's the objective. These are objectives that is mentioned in the syllabus, and if you see the actual syllabus, I have put all the syllabus content in 16 weeks. You all know that we follow 16 weeks program, right? So now today, actually last week we could not discuss anything, so I'll introduce the course today, and then we will discuss a little bit about some content today. Okay, so the first unit talks about general introduction to disaster and resilience, and where different types of natural disasters occurrence and disaster, okay, how often it occurs, can we understand a cycle of these occurrence, okay, what we can learn from it. Okay, so for example, if you must have already come across that 100-year flood. When we say flood, if you have keenly observed or read news articles, they say that this is 100-year flood, this is 50-year flood. So what is this 50-year flood, 100-year flood? So are we expecting every 100 years there's some kind of flood? If that is the case, how do we read it, all that? Okay, so there is apart from introducing the the general types of disaster, and there is a very detailed discussion about occurrence in terms of climate and in terms of geographical regions and so on and so forth. Okay, and what I'll do is probably we'll have two lectures on this. One, I'll briefly discuss about the different types of natural disasters critically, and in second lecture we'll specifically discuss about India as a case and some statistics, recent statistics on you know, what are the different types of disaster we face and which is the most predominant one and what we what the government of India does and all that. Okay, so this is the first unit where general introduction about disaster is discussed. Last time I told you that there are only two kinds of disaster that has been discussed in your syllabus. One is on cyclone and earthquake. Okay, I actually forgot that the syllabus was revised for you. In the new syllabus, which is approved by the Senate, we have included flood also as one of the disasters that needs to be discussed here. Okay, so why we are discussing only these three things is because these disasters are prevalent here, southern part of where our institute is there. Okay, earthquake is of course one, cyclone is the second. Of course, flood is also another disaster that we encounter. So that the flood component is added in the revised syllabus. So that's why when I discussed last time, I actually did not check the updated syllabus, but this is added in the new syllabus. Okay, so we will discuss about flood in two classes, where we'll discuss about floods in India, what are the causes of flood and what are the types of flood, and we'll also see what are the preventive measures taken, okay, in all this case. And here one of my PhD scholar is also working on a similar line of research, where she's trying to understand how topography, okay, for example, when we build build buildings, okay, we actually alter the terrain. For example, let us say we have, let's say, we have a natural terrain, something like this, okay, when we and the water or the natural stream has the tendency to take this curve, and it knows, okay, how to flow, what is the direction in which it has to flow. Okay, however, when we build buildings, what we do, we try to either elevate, okay, and then we make certain cut and fill, okay, because we want a flat land for building, right? So we actually change the topography of the land surface, okay, actually, which is supposed to be something like this. Okay, we have modified to suit our requirements like this. Okay, however, when we encounter some kind of disaster, like for example, especially flood, okay, it does not read the altered topography. Because it has its own natural path, okay, so when that path is altered and if that natural path is not honored, we encounter disaster, right? So one of my PhD scholars, she is working on this line, how this altered topography is actually causing floods in major cities in India. Okay, so maybe I will also invite her sometime when we discuss about the second unit about flood, and how she can also discuss about what is altered topography, what is topography, and how we are damaging it, all that. Okay, so this is the second, this is the first disaster that is discussed in the syllabus. Okay, the third one, the second disaster that is explicitly discussed is on the earthquake. Okay, and in the first unit we will discuss about the signs of earthquake. Okay, so what are the causes of earthquake and what are the types and some of the key terminology that we should understand when we talk about earthquake, and also the load balance. Okay, so probably in structures you must have read there are three types of loads, right? One is called seismic load, other one is called wind load, and the third one is of course live load, where people are the living is considered. Otherwise there are two types of load, one is called seismic load and other one is wind load, right? So how a building behaves when it comes to earthquake and how building responds to the high wind, that we will discuss. Okay, so this is the second type of disaster that is mentioned in the syllabus. Okay, and we will discuss this little extensively because there is some science component involved in it and also some best practices and case studies that needs to be discussed. So this is this probably will take 3 weeks to discuss all the contents that is mentioned here. Okay, this is second type of disaster that we'll read about. Third type of disaster that we will read about this, of course, is the cyclone. Okay, so cyclone is one of the major disaster that occurs or that hits Indian subcontinent, particularly the Bay of Bengal side, the tropical cyclones that we encounter. Okay, primarily the cyclones affecting the Bay of Bengal side, from that side. Okay, here as well we will read about some signs, how this cyclones are formed, what is whirlwind. There are so many terminologies that we have to understand when we discuss about these cyclones. Okay, so we will also explore, we will also learn about little bit about signs, and then we'll also see what are the best practices that is available prescribed by the code, for example National Building Code, and as well we have other regulatory mechanism as well. We will discuss about that in some of the lectures. Okay, and then we have last unit where traditional and indigenous system is discussed, where we'll talk about how traditional knowledge will help in responding to climate and also some of the disaster that we have discussed. Okay, so with that we will that's how the entire content is discussed or listed. We will go to the details of each of the component that is discussed in your syllabus. Okay, and also in the last 3 weeks I am keeping it open for you to present. What you will present is any one of the key topics. You can pick out any one keywords from here. For example, let us say types of natural disaster. Somebody can read about types of natural disaster only on that. Okay, don't go here and there. Just what is natural disaster and what are the types. Okay, and you can have some 10-15 slides explaining this, or somebody is, let's say, is interested in flood zoning. What is flood zoning and how flood zones are mapped? Okay, and with examples you can take. Or for example, somebody wants to read about flood mitigation measures. Okay, so what measures can be taken at city level, at neighborhood level, or at being an architecture student, what we can do for flood mitigation. So any one topic, you take any based on your interest, in from any of the keywords that is there in the syllabus. Okay, you can pick any general topic as well, or you can take any specific. For example, let's say specific keywords, for example bluff body, okay, built form and earthquake, okay, and also behavioral of buildings to earthquake, okay, seismic effect related to buildings, okay, something like that. Or if somebody is interested to know about the science of wind, okay, for example, aerodynamics of bluff bodies, what is vertex shading, okay, all these keywords are related to the wind and the air movement. Okay, so somebody, if somebody is interested, you can take all these things and take only one thing, but kindly go in deep and then understand it and then make presentations, make slides, and you will have presentation at the end of the semester. Last 3 weeks I am keeping it for your presentation. Okay, so that's the content that is there in the syllabus. And what is expected from the course? Students completing this course will be able to utilize the knowledge of built resilience and traditional system gained through the study through various case studies and so on and so forth, and apply the knowledge about the whatever we have learned, also about not only about disaster, also about the climate responsive approaches that probably that we will learn about. Okay, so this is the overall content, and I request maybe at the end of the class or maybe in the next class, I want everyone to, I will probably open up one Excel file, okay, so where you can write your registration number, name and topic that you want to read, okay, so that we can kick start this parallelly. Okay, so this is one thing that I thought I'll highlight. Other thing is, of course, we will have three assessments. Okay, so one, the first one will be test, that probably in the fourth or fifth or sixth week, and the second assessment, you all know that we have mid semester exam, and that will also be a written test, and the third assessment will be based on your presentation. Okay, so that's how I have thought I will conduct this particular course. Okay, and there are certain reference material that is mentioned in the syllabus. Okay, so many of the presentation that I will be making is primarily based on these references. Okay, so I will be sharing some reading materials apart from, of course, I will share my PPT. Okay, so where you can take the crisp synthesized information about each topic. However, if somebody is interested to know more about the intricacies and details of each topic, probably you may have to look in for references. This is actually listed in your syllabus, and apart from that, I have also gathered some more in reference material that will also be useful if somebody is interested to know more about it. Okay. And lastly, why I am interested in this subject, okay, what is my interest on this subject, and because this is slightly engineering driven, right? Normally architects don't talk about this kind of engineering aspect. Okay, this is normally left to the civil engineers or somebody from other experts, other fields experts are given this task to describe, or they take up this kind of subject. However, I am slightly inclined towards this kind of approaches, okay, scientific approaches to understanding of these disaster. Okay, and I also, we are doing one of the projects that is on building urban resilient communities, BURICOM. Probably you must be aware of such project being done in School of Planning and Architecture, Vijayawada, right? And this is actually a Erasmus program, European Union funded project. It's a 3-year project where we are trying to document best practices, that is best practices on disaster from different parts of the country, okay, and not only country, across the world. Just 1 second. Yeah, I was explaining about this. We are doing one of the project here that is EU funded, where we are trying to document some of the best case studies on disaster management. Not only disaster management, we can say it is a varied case study. There are case studies about traditional knowledge. Okay, just one second. Sorry, I'm interrupting you. Just one second. Sorry about the interruption. Okay, so some confusion. Okay, so I was just saying that we are doing one project, European Union funded, where we are trying to document best case studies about the resilient measures taken in Indian case. Okay, so we have case studies in Himachal. We have case studies in Mumbai, we have case studies in Bhopal, Bangalore, Vijayawada, and so on and so forth. Okay, so maybe in when we go further, I will also discuss some of the case studies that we have done under this project. And also we under DIC, Design Innovation Center, we are actually developing a temporary housing solution for this kind of disasters. Okay, so when we talk about disaster, there are certain measures that we take. Okay, for example, asking people to assemble in certain common places. Okay, so where there is less where there is less risk of disaster. Those are called safe zones and so on and so forth, right? So in those places, actually, if you see, it's all mass people gathered in one place, and without any subdivisions or without any individual private places for them, right? So we thought, although we ask people to gather in one place and assemble them in a safer place, still in the same place we can come out with very simple solution where that privacy is maintained. Okay, so we have developed one prototype on temporary housing. Probably I'll also show sometime what is that we have as of now, and what we can how we are progressing it. Yeah, so that is one thing. Apart from that, and last week we have published one book that is on resilient and livable city planning. I have invited, and many, I think some of you have attended the conference as well. Okay, and as a result of the conference, we have published one book as well that is on case studies and theoretical and scientific studies from across the country. Over 275 authors have collaborated, and over 96 papers are there, okay, discussing various aspects of disaster and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is also why I'm highlighting all this is this is one of my subject where I'm also interested in learning things and probably use this knowledge for further investigation, for further scientific work. Okay, and apart from that, I have done some case study works on housing, transient housing in Jammu, where these kind of houses were prepared after a major flood, okay, that took place in 2005. Okay, so and then some case studies I have done, documented and published. These are published works, okay, published book chapters in reputed books. Okay, and apart from that, as a part of this Birukom, we have done a case study in Vijayawada, where we have tried to explore how the heat is perceived by low income people. Okay, so normally heat is also one form of extreme heat is also one form of disaster. Probably when we see the theory, we will learn about it. Okay, so how these disaster, how these low income people cope with this kind of disaster. Okay, so how they manage to do it. Okay, and I have actually repeated it. There is one more paper which I have I think forgot to put. There are two things that we have done. One is of course the interview. We have conducted a series of interview with the local people on to document how they perceive heat. The second thing what we did was we mapped certain settlements in these local low income housing settlements, and then we simulated the performance of these individual units. Okay, how these low income housing settlements perform to the extreme heat conditions. Okay, so what we can do as an architect and planners to bring down the intensity of these heat, okay, through planning and architectural measures. Okay, and other project, and which probably I will also be showing it to you, is on the Chennai flood. We did model in 2005, not 2005, I think in 2017 we mapped this. If I have to summarize this, actually what we found was there were around 300 square kilometers of water body in 1970s, okay, when as per the records, okay, in Chennai, and these water bodies were supposed to act as sponges in terms of when flood occurs or any disaster occurs, especially flood. These are kind of a reservoirs where water will flow, and the city will not get flooded as a result of it. However, if you see, when we mapped in 2016-17 period time, what we found was only 50 to 75 square kilometers of water body alone was found in 2015, 16 period time. So that means there is a loss of almost 250 square kilometers of water bodies in the city of Chennai, and that is also one of the reason why the flood that occurred was so devastating. Okay, because we have encroached all those places, and as a result, when flood occurred, and these area got inundated. Okay, so probably I'll also show these are all again published works. I'll show you some in some of the classes how we have done, what we did, and what we recommended as well. And recently I also presented one of the papers here in the same conference last week, where we have tried to quantify the impact of green and blue in the proposed city of Amravati. Okay, so again here if I have to summarize this, there we have two cases. Okay, one is Vijayawada city, and the other one is the proposed Amravati. If you see the temperature profile as of now, highest temperature it reaches around 40 at the time of study. I'll tell you in that particular period of study, we found that around the highest temperature can reach up to 38 degree, and the lowest temperature can come up to 28 degree Celsius. Okay, in core city of Vijayawada. However, if you see in Amravati case, where the building has yet to come, only road has been done, and greenery is a little bit of greenery and water is there. Highest temperature remained same, similar to Vijayawada, where 38 degrees Celsius was observed. Similar temperature was observed in Vijayawada as well. However, lower temperature, it went up to 23 degrees Celsius, whereas in this city, the lowest temperature was only 28 degrees Celsius. Okay, so there is actually a difference of 5 degrees Celsius. Higher temperature is observed in the city. We know that through a concept called UHI, right? Urban heat islands. So urban areas have got the tendency to trap heat and retain it. Okay, so this 5 degree plus 5 degree is observed because we have buildings that retains heat. Okay, so the temperature, which is supposed to be naturally 23 degrees Celsius, that how we observe in the Amravati case, was 28 degrees Celsius, 5 degrees higher. How we can mitigate this? How we can bring this temperature down from 28 to 23, which we normally should be observing, is through integration of green and blue in the city. Okay, and also coming out using appropriate materials that do not retain the heat for longer period of time in the building. So we did some experiments on that and how we can actually bring this temperature down, and whether proposed green and blue that is there in the master plan is sufficient to achieve this or not, we have discussed it. Okay, so probably I'll also discuss about this probably in one of the classes. Yeah, okay, so this is what I have to say about the content, and what are the different possibilities in which we can discuss about this subject, and some of the works that I have personally involved in this topic. Okay, so I think with this I will stop for now. If you have any questions, we can. Okay, so like I said, the first unit discusses about three components. First is on different types of disaster and occurrence of disaster in different places, and particularly we will talk about India as a case in one of the discussions. What are the different types of disaster? We will see theoretically to understand how do we conceptualize the entire theme itself. So if you see the word disaster, there are different definitions adapted to define disaster. Okay, disaster is an extreme disruption of functioning of society that causes widespread human, material and environmental losses that exceeds the ability of affected society to cope with. Okay, normally we use this word very often, but if you actually see the details of it, that is very important. If you go into details of it and then understand what happens in a disaster, then we will actually understand the intensity of disaster and also the kind of responses that we have to take. Okay, so actually it says extreme disruption of functioning of a society. Okay, for example, COVID also one kind of disaster, right? So we were stopped from going out and we were confined to houses. Everything was stopped, no travel, nothing. Okay, we all were confined to houses. Okay, so that is also one thing. Okay, where normal life, the functioning of normal life is stopped. Okay, and that causes widespread human, material and environmental loss. Okay, these are the primary things that we will be understanding through this disaster. Okay, and what we can do to minimize the environmental loss, minimize the material and economic loss and almost eliminate the human loss. What we can do is what we will be learning from this subject. Okay, and also if you see the other part of the definition, it says it exceeds the ability of affected society to cope with. Okay, so it is not a normal situation. We don't have a control over it. Okay, we don't have the ability to control this. Okay, so this beyond our control. That's why the it is called disaster. Actually, and other things, other definitions. For example, disaster is an event or series of event which gives rise to casualties or damage or loss of properties, infrastructure, environment, essential services, or means of livelihood in such scale which means beyond the normal capacity of the affected community. Okay, there are so many keywords that you can see here. Of course, the loss of life, human life especially. Okay, damages to the property, loss of homes, loss of other properties, and so on and so forth. Loss of infrastructure, loss in terms of, for example, let's say physical infrastructure, electricity, mobile networks, and water supply networks, and so on and so forth. Okay, and of course, it can be in terms of environment, essential services. For example, water is an essential service. If that is disrupted, okay, and also it can affect the livelihood. Livelihood means the work, okay, the work that we do. Or for example, let's say I'm dependent on certain kind of work. Okay, my livelihood is actually stopped or scrapped because of this. For example, let's say we had migrants issues, right? So during the COVID time, so their work is actually, there is no work for them anymore. Okay, so they wanted to move from the city to their respective villages. Right, so these are the certain situations. These are the situations that will arise because of these kind of disasters. Okay, and which is actually beyond the coping capacity of the society. Okay, and if you see further, it says disaster is catastrophic situation in which the normal pattern of life or ecosystem has been disturbed. And an extraordinary emergency intervention is required to save and preserve the lives and the built environment. Okay, so we need extraordinary efforts, and also in a short time, and also in a, it is kind of emergency, right? So the step has to be taken so that the normalcy is brought. Okay, and these are generic definitions that we can come across. We have a act, Government of India has an act, our country has an act called the Disaster Management Act 2005. Okay, so what is an act? Probably you must be aware by now. Act is not something where it is a compulsory for all the acts are nothing but the rule of law, which is compulsory for all the fellow citizens and also the governments to follow on. Okay, for example, let's say we the lockdowns. If you have seen the notifications from Government of India, they say that under the Act, Disaster Management 2005, the lockdowns are stipulated. Okay, so these are. These are acts enacted by the government, and it has to be strictly followed and implemented in the country. Of course, for the better for the betterment of people. Okay, so under this act, we have a, the Government of India has adopted a definition which says, disasters are nothing but a catastrophe, mishap, or calamity, or a grave occurrence in any area arising from natural or man-made. It can be both, okay, or by accident or by negligence. This is also possible, and which results in substantial loss of life, human suffering, damage to and destruction of properties, okay, or damage or degradation of environmental degradation of environment, and is of such a nature or magnitude as to beyond the coping capacity of the community. Okay, so if you observe this in all the definition, this last sentence is more or less there, right? So these are some things which are beyond a normal society can manage. Okay, so we can't manage this. Some extraordinary efforts, collective efforts, has to be put so that we can get back to normalcy. Okay, so this is one of the definition that is adapted by the government of India to define disaster. And also the United Nations has its own definition. It says the occurrence of sudden or major misfortune which disrupts the basic fabric and normal functioning of a society. Okay, so these are some definitions that we can think of, and also keywords that is used to define these disasters. Okay, and of course there are two types of disaster. One is natural and other one is man-made disaster. Okay, and primarily in this course we'll be discussing extensively on natural disasters only, and probably some brief discussions on man-made disasters. That is how it is written. Disasters caused by chemical and industrial accidents, environmental pollution, transport accidents, and political unrest are classified as human-made disaster or human-induced disasters. Okay, and of course we know that natural disasters are through nature. Okay, maybe it can be cloudburst or flood or earthquake or cyclone, and because this is a natural phenomenon. Okay, and if you see the types of disaster, the entire disaster can be theoretically classified into five. Okay, so one is disaster pertaining to geophysical, hydrological disaster, meteorological disaster, climatological disaster, and biological disaster. Okay, so what is geophysical disaster and how do we understand that? If there are three things that are put under geophysical disaster, one is earthquake, mass movement of earth materials, the second one is volcanoes, and the third one is tsunami. These are put under geophysical disasters. Okay, so under earthquake, this is one of the topics that we will be dealing in detail. For now, just a brief thing, that what are the components that can be discussed under earthquake. It can be direct earthquake itself. Okay, that itself is one disaster. Apart from that, landslides followed by earthquake, urban fires followed by the earthquakes are triggered by the earthquake, liquefaction. Probably you must have already come across this word in structures. What is liquefaction? Where building probably when we see the detail we will go into. I'll explain you that time, but you remember that the soil loses its bearing capacity. Okay, so you must have seen images where actually buildings sunk. Okay, the earth sunks and the building collapses. Okay, so these are nothing naturally. Okay, without any anything, we may not be able to see what is happening on the top. Okay, but under the earth there is a shift in the earth's mass. Okay, and the soil loses its capacity to hold any solid object on top, and there is a transformation of the soil. Okay, that is also possible. Mass movement of earth material downwards in the slope, or surface displacement of earthen material that is also possible apart from the earthquake. Okay, and volcanoes we have seen actually we don't have in India as such where we can that will be a threat to the Indian subcontinent, but in other places this is one of the one of the thing that we that needs to be addressed. Okay, and of course tsunami is also put under geophysical disaster, where of course Indian subcontinent is also prone to the tsunamis. Okay, so that's the first classification, geophysical disaster, under which we have earthquake, volcanoes and tsunamis. The second type of disaster is called hydrological disaster. Okay, so where flood, landslides and wave actions are put. Okay, so and other things like avalanches, coastal erosions are all associated with hydrological disasters. Okay, so of course we will be going in deep, and since there is one chapter exclusively on what is flood, what are the types of flood, and what are the mitigation measures that we can we have, okay, and what we can learn further, and all that can be we will discuss in detail little later, yeah, in when we talk about floods. Okay, but as of now you can remember that we will be the flood is put under a broad category of hydrological disaster. Okay, so one case here in geophysical we will read about earthquake, in hydrological disaster we'll read about flood. Okay, and other things are there, flash flood and hydrological flood hydrology. We will see what is flash flood and what is normal flood, what is the difference and how it impacts the city. Okay, and can we do something through planning and design intervention? All that we will discuss when we talk, when we go in detail of it. Wave action again is we have seen landslide prior to this as well. Wave action is another kind of disaster that is put under hydrological theme. Okay, where which impacts the fragile ecosystem of the earth surface. Okay, so but we will not be going into details of all this, but you can remember that there are flood is common one, flood, landslides, earthquake are common, but apart from that there are other types of disasters as well that we encounter, and but it is less prevalent. Okay, this is the second type of disaster that we have that we can remember. Third one is meteorological disaster. Okay, where cyclone, storm surge, tornadoes are discussed. Okay, and again here as well we will discuss about one disaster, that is cyclone, under meteorological case. Okay, now of course extreme temperatures are all also put under meteorological disaster, but the syllabus does not discusses extensively about this topic, but I will introduce you the case studies that we have done in Vijayawada, that is on extreme temperature. Okay, so how the cities cope up with extreme temperature, what we can do, how at building level extreme temperatures can be managed, and what interventions can be done. Okay, so under meteorological disaster we will read about cyclones, especially the details of it we will go through. And the fourth type of disaster is climatological. Okay, where unusual extreme weather conditions related to long-lived meso to macro scale atmospheric processes ranging from intra-seasonal to multi-decadal climate variability. For example, let's say extreme drought conditions, extreme hot or cold conditions, forest fires, and other other disasters pertaining to where climate plays a major role. Okay, so of course, climate change can all be broadly will be discussed under this theme, climatological disaster, but probably will not be going into any details of this. Okay, but we will see at policy level what we can do. Okay, and at of course at building level we do many initiatives. For example, let's say we call it that all the buildings has to be climate responsive, right? So that is also one of the mitigative measures that we inherently take. We train or we ask all the architects, right, to design buildings which are responsive to climate. Okay, so some policy level issues we will discuss under this climatological disaster. Fifth one is biological disaster, and I think we are now with this current time, this requires very less introduction, and this requires little less explanation, because we know we have faced it, we are facing it actually, right? So what is this biological disaster? And probably last year when I explained, probably many of us may not have understood the intensity or the severity of this biological disaster, except let's say for example nuclear disaster or spread of some disease I can talk about, but we have actually experienced it, right? So how it can impact everyone, in fact each and everyone is affected by this COVID condition as of now, right? So these are broadly five types of disaster that we have, we can classify, and under each category we will be going and learning about one component. Under geospatial we will learn about earthquake, under hydrological disaster we'll learn about flooding, and probably under meteorological disaster we'll learn a little bit about cyclone and about the climate. Now we can put it under fourth category as well. Okay, so biological disaster we don't have in the syllabus anything, but I will also present you one case study where I have done comparative study of Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata and Chennai, how the COVID has spread, and is there a relationship between urban density, population density and spread of COVID. Okay, and which city is performing better, and what planning and urban design interventions may help in future to minimize the impact. Okay, so this is not part of the syllabus, but I think we will discuss sometime how what measures can be taken. Okay, I think with this I will stop for the day, and if you have any questions you can ask me, otherwise we will stop.